In the preceding videos, we've seen how generation of a proton gradient by the electron transport chain allows synthesis of ATP, as ATP synthase allows protons to flow down their electrochemical gradient. Synthesis of ATP in this general way was proposed by Peter Mitchell in 1961 as the chemiosmotic hypothesis, and subsequent evidence has established that Mitchell was correct. But ATP synthesized in the mitochondrial matrix is not much good to the rest of the cell if it cannot leave the matrix. Likewise, we need a way to get ADP and phosphate into the matrix so they can be combined to make ATP. I'll now describe how ATP leaves the matrix and ADP and phosphate get in. The inner mitochondrial membrane contains an antiporter that moves ATP out of the matrix and ADP from the intermembrane space into the matrix. A different transporter, a symporter, moves a phosphate ion along with a proton into the matrix. The energy for both of these processes comes from the electrochemical gradient across the membrane. Because ATP has one more phosphate group than ADP, ATP is more negatively charged than ADP. So this process, the exchange of ATP in the matrix for ADP in the intermembrane space, results in net movement of one negative charge out of the matrix, or, put another way, net movement of one positive charge into the matrix. This is favorable because the matrix side of the membrane carries a negative charge relative to the other side. But for movement of phosphate, the net change in the charge in the matrix is zero because the phosphate is negatively charged and the proton is positively charged. So of these two processes, only the exchange of ATP and ADP uses the electrical potential part of the electrochemical gradient. The other component that contributes to the electrochemical gradient is the proton concentration differential. During exchange of ATP and ADP, no protons are moved across the membrane, so the pH difference across the membrane is unaffected. However, transport of phosphate is driven by the proton moving from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration, which is an energetically favorable process. So of these two processes, only movement of phosphate uses energy from the proton concentration difference part of the electrochemical gradient. Taken together then, the movement of an ATP out of the matrix and an ADP and a phosphate into the matrix uses the energy equivalent of one proton that had been pumped out of the matrix by the electron transport chain. Taking all these processes into account, we can calculate how many ATPs can be made and exported using the energy from transfer of two electrons from NADH onto oxygen. Recall the transfer of electrons from one NADH to O2 allows pumping of 10 protons out of the matrix. Now, if we round to the nearest integer, synthesis of an ATP requires movement of 3 protons back into the matrix. An export of that ATP and import of the substrates for ATP synthesis requires movement of 1 additional proton back into the matrix. So overall, synthesis and export of ATP costs the energy from 4 protons pumped by the electron transport chain. That means that oxidation of one NADH molecule allows synthesis and export of 2.5 ATP molecules. Similarly, transport of electrons from one QH2 to O2 allows pumping of 6 protons across the membrane. When these 6 protons flow back into the matrix through ATP synthase and the transporters, they allow synthesis and export of 1.5 molecules of ATP. Now we can calculate how many ATP can be made from oxidation of one molecule of glucose. Recall that glycolysis produces 2 NADH and 2 ATP in the cytosol. The electrons from the 2 cytosolic NADH are transferred to 2 matrix NADH using the malate aspartate shuttle, and each of the matrix NADH allows synthesis and export of 2.5 ATP, as we have just seen. Therefore, the 2 NADH from glycolysis allow production and export of 5 ATP. Oxidation of each pyruvate to acetyl-CoA and carbon dioxide produces 1 NADH, and since we get 2 pyruvates from each glucose, the yield from this step is also 5 ATP. Each turn of the citric acid cycle produces 3 NADH, 1 QH2, and 1 GTP. and therefore 2 turns of the cycle will give us 6 NADH, 2 QH2, and 2 GTP. The 6 NADH are worth 15 ATP total, the 2 QH2 are worth 3 total, and of course the 2 GTP are 2 ATP equivalents. So the citric acid cycle steps of this oxidation process give us 20 ATP total. Adding all of these numbers gives us a total of 32 ATP produced from oxidation of a single glucose molecule in liver, kidney, and heart muscle. You should understand how I arrived at this number for the test. Note that the fermentations we looked at produce only 2 molecules of ATP per glucose molecule metabolized. Therefore, it is much more efficient in terms of ATP yield to metabolize glucose aerobically. This concludes our study of oxidative phosphorylation. In the next topic, I will describe fatty acid metabolism.